Hello, lovely internet strangers. In today's video, I will be ranting about this article, Your Bookshelf May Be Part of the Problem, in which the author proposes decolonizing your bookshelf. This article was sent to me by two friends who don't support the ideas and sent it to me because they know my views and they also know my background in publishing. Many subscribers of this channel have asked me to do more videos related to publishing, and this seemed like the perfect opportunity to marry the current topical moment with my background and a rant, which I love to do. So I'm gonna rant about this article in particular, but I'm also going to talk about the history of this kind of thinking in the publishing industry, at least since the time that I entered the industry. So there's been this idea floating around that people tend to read too much within their own experience. Of course, that was not meant universally. What they meant was white people read too many books about just white people, and they don't read books about people of other cultures. They don't center voices of the marginalized. So at the beginning, there was just this idea going around that people should try to diversify what they read. And this was meant universally. This was try to read a fantasy novel that's not just set in generic Western Europe. Try to read memoirs from people outside your experience so you can walk a mile in someone else's shoes. And I was definitely on board the diversity train at the beginning, not just because I was part of the ideology, but also because I read a lot and I got bored of reading the same old story. So when I would read young adult fantasy novels, they were all based in the same kind of generic fantasy worlds, and I enjoyed reading stories that were more specifically based on China or Brazil or some other society with different cultural background that brought a different texture and specificity to the story. And so first there was just a cry for hashtag we need diverse books. That just meant people needed to write more diverse stories. Stories with characters from different backgrounds, but anyone could write these stories because that's what it means to be an author. You make things up. You study history and people. You create characters, borrow things from different cultural narratives, and weave your own tale. You should do your research. This goes true of any kind of novel that's based on any particular time in history or culture. You don't want to try to write a novel based on 1930s Depression era America and not know the first thing about it. However, We Need Diverse Books quickly moved over to become hashtag own voices, which meant not just that we need diverse books, but that those diverse books needed to be written by people who actually were somehow part of that identity or that experience. Meaning, we need Black stories to be written by Black people. We need Latino stories to be written by Latino people. Now, the own voices part is where they started to lose me because I was like, well, following that logic, then we should all just be writing memoir. Like, how specific are we going to get? I'm Latina, but my experience being Latina is not identical to anyone else's. And Latinos are a good example because they're not really an identity. There are so many different countries, depending where you grew up. If you were born in America and just have that heritage, or if you're born in the actual country, you have a totally different experience. Mexico does not have the same kind of history and culture as Argentina, as Ecuador. If you grew up in suburbia versus an urban environment versus a rural environment. So I was like, what does this even mean? It means we need to center writers of color, marginalized voices, but it's not just enough for them to write the books if no one reads them, right? Because you could say, write a book, write whatever you want, no one's stopping you. You can even self-publish these days. It's incredibly easy. Go forth, write, put your story out into the world. Do it. I'm behind you 100%. But the market is going to tell you whether anyone wants to read that story. Now, the problem is marginalized identities are, by definition, small portions of the population. Therefore, they are a small portion of the reading public. And the thing that people don't want to talk about is that some of the minority identities have a smaller portion of readers. This is a problem in Latino culture. I've talked about this with someone in the publishing industry who is Latino, who says it's not enough to get Latinos to write. We have to get Latinos to understand that they should spend money on books by Latinos to support those authors and show the economic viability of those stories. This is a thing you see in the romance industry where there's been all this kerfuffle about diverse romances. And the problem is the market share for those is not very large. People who self-publish and do digital only can do very well, but at traditional publishers, it's much harder. Now, good stories are good stories. If you write a good book, it doesn't matter what the race or ethnicity or culture depicts in the book, people will buy it and they will like it. The problem is, this is something I've seen especially in young adult fiction, people focus too much on the identity and the culture. They'll see their novel as like a vehicle to teach people about this culture when what they should be doing is writing a story. You can make the culture inform the plot. You can make a character's cultural identity a huge part of their character that influences the way they act, but your job as an author is to tell a damn story. So this comic perfectly illustrates this idea. One girl says, "How's your comic coming?" The other girl says, "Pretty cutting edge. The characters are queer POC. The first girl says, "How about their personalities?" And the second girl says, "They're what?" I've loved that since I saw it because it perfectly illustrates this problem. Now, on to the article. I have not read this article fully yet, so I'm going to be experiencing it along with you. Most of you will know what NPR is all about, but if you don't, NPR is the outlet that you read as a good liberal so you can be woke and informed and know exactly how to virtue signal around the water cooler the next day, or in current year, the Slack channel. So NPR tells you what you should know about and how you can be better. It gets you to read because you're like, oh my god, my bookshelf may be part of the problem. I have to figure out how I can help, how I can be a better person. Books, when people come to them early enough or at the right time, have the power to be transformative. And for a lot of readers, this is the right time. Witness the many anti-racist book lists circulating on social media. That's a whole other rant I could do. We must recognize the inherent value that good literature has and the ability of language to strike an emotional chord. But someone, at some point, has to get down to the business of reading, as Lauren Michelle Jackson writes at Vulture. Simply handing someone a book cannot automatically make them care. This is something I remind myself whenever anti-racist lists start to make the rounds online. Grown white men in their 40s, for example. Oh, just for example, let's just talk about older white men. No reason. Cracking open James Baldwin or Toni Morrison for the first time, after cities are already ablaze, are not going to eradicate racism. It will not put an end to the systemic injustice that has plagued this country for more than 400 years. Alright, so we don't need to read the rest of this article, right? Because you just told us that this isn't gonna do anything. Awesome. Oh wait, there's more article. That's weird. Still, there's always a still or a but or a yet. Still, I can't help but wonder whether some people have considered that, at a basic level, the homogenous nature of their personal library and what that represents is a part of the problem. No, it is fucking not. I'm gonna take a stance right now and say what's on your bookshelf is not part of the fucking problem. It's just not. Most people's personal library is just a reflection of their personal preferences, and most people are boring. Most people don't try hard. They just read what everyone else reads. So yeah, NPR can have an influence if they give people a book list because people decide what to read based on Obama's book list, Oprah's book list, NPR's book list. Most people are sheep. If you want to change what the sheep read, put out these lists, tell them what to read. Their personal library is a reflection of what you, NPR, and other outlets like it, tell them to read. And the rest? It comes from what their parents read to them when they were children. It comes from what their friends were reading and recommended. And it just comes from personality. Some people like to read horror, some people like to read sci-fi, and people tend to go for what's popular or what's recommended. So yes, if you want to make a difference, write lists about books that people should read that are by Black authors or Asian authors, etc. However, preferably, you're recommending these books with an eye toward it being something the other person will enjoy, not because you want to educate them, not because you think they should read it. Sure, when you're in school, you have to read things based on what the teacher tells you to read. But once you're out in the world, you don't have to read, and you can read whatever you want. You don't have to read to educate yourself. Some people read because they want to escape the world. My dad has talked about the fact that there's all these books now that come out for middle grade and YA depicting that experience growing up essentially in the ghetto, so kids can relate to it. And he's like, I didn't want to read books that show what I could see outside my window. I wanted to get away from that. I wanted to read sci-fi and fantasy and imagine a better world, not about a kid living in the ghetto just like me. Not to say that there isn't a market for those stories, but not everyone wants to read about that. And I would argue that most people who are going to read one of these books that's going to take them outside their experience are already open-minded people. They don't need to read a book to find out about that culture. I always see these lists like 10 books to combat Islamophobia. I'm like, anyone who is legitimately Islamophobic, because that term gets thrown around, is not gonna be convinced by reading a book from your combating Islamophobia list. Now, I'm not discounting the power of reading or books, because believe me, I love books. I've been reading since a very early age, and I think that stories in general, not not just books, have the power to be incredibly meaningful to people, to show them a path, to show them something they hadn't considered, to make them feel better about their own experience, to escape. But this whole idea that you're gonna read these books outside your experience and then you're gonna understand and be a better person, it's all just pats on the back. What are you gonna do after you read these books? This whole part of the problem thing just plays on people's guilt, their white guilt in this case, and it makes them perk up because they don't wanna be part of the problem and they wanna be told how to be a good person. So here is an instruction manual from NPR. You may have seen the phrase, decolonize your bookshelf, floating around. I would posit that most people have not, because this is still a fringe phrase. I'm honestly surprised this is not a Book Riot post that got mispublished on NPR, because they have definitely talked about decolonizing your bookshelf. In fact, they promoted a company that was selling t-shirts that said, decolonize your bookshelf. So in essence, decolonizing your bookshelf is about actively resisting and casting aside the colonialist ideas of narrative, storytelling, and literature that have pervaded the American psyche for so long. I don't even know where to start. Now, I think what they're going to say is that people who are not white have different ways of telling stories than white people, which is true in certain senses, but that seems to imply that white people don't already imply a variety of storytelling techniques, that there have not been waves of different movements in literature throughout the ages, and that people who are not white are somehow other, that they have these other methods of telling stories, that they are not like us white people, and we need to learn their ways. I'm not saying that being from a different country, being from a different race, can't give you a different perspective in your writing, and that maybe you have studied the literature of your country. At the end of the day, a story is a story. A good story is a good story. And this whole use of the word colonialist and decolonize is just ridiculous, because they'll propose reading things from different cultures and countries and things like that, like read something from Japan. What the hell does that have to do with colonialism? If you are white, I am. I'm Latina, but all my whiteness is showing on my face, so that's all that matters to these people. Take a moment to examine your bookshelf. What do you see? What books and authors have you allowed to influence your worldview and how you process the issues of racism and prejudice toward the disenfranchised? Have you considered that if you identify as white and read only the work of white authors, you are in some ways listening to an extension of your own voice on repeat? This is such bullshit. All white authors think exactly the same and they write exactly the same. They're from the same places, they're the same age. They all grew up in this one place. They all had the exact same life experience. They all have the same personality. They studied writing from the same people. That's it. All white people are the same. Look, you could go your entire life reading books only by white people and have an incredibly varied literary experience. Lowbrow, highbrow, books set in different countries, historical, romance, with unreliable narrators, with different timelines, postmodern literature, modern, Victorian. Now I think you could also make that case for Black authors. You could only read Black authors and you could have a very varied reading experience and be perfectly happy. And you could only read books by women and have a very varied reading experience, because all women don't write the same. All women don't think the same. All Black people don't write the same. All Black people don't think the same. So to look at your bookshelf and say that mostly the authors are white, or mostly the authors are Black, or mostly the authors are women, or mostly the authors are men, has nothing to do with the makeup of your bookshelf. It says more to say most of your books are sci-fi, or most of your books are romance, most of your books are young adult fiction, most of your bookshelf is filled with comics, most of your bookshelf is filled with books on economics. That will tell you something. At least they somewhat acknowledge my point. While the details and depth of experience may differ, white voices have dominated what has been considered canon for eons. That means non-white readers have had to process stories and historical events through a white author's lens. The problem goes deeper than that anyway, considering that even now 76% of publishing professionals, the people you might call the gatekeepers, are white. There are many reasons why 76% of publishing professionals are white. I'm not going to go into them here because that would be a whole video in and of itself, but also they're not the gatekeepers anymore. Anyone can publish a book anytime they want. Yes, it can be tricky to self-publish, but especially if you have a more marginalized voice, a more specific kind of story you want to tell, and you're willing to put in the work, you can have have an audience. So there are no gatekeepers anymore. As far as wanting to sell your book at like Stephen King level, then sure. But if you just want to be published, if you want people to read your book, no one is stopping you. No one is stopping people from setting up independent presses that will publish different kinds of books. And in fact, those kinds of presses exist. Reading broadly and with intention is how we encounter dehumanization and demand visibility, effectively bridging the gap between what we read and how we might live in a more just and equitable society. I fundamentally disagree with this BS idea that you owe it to the world to read broadly and with intention and open your mind to other people's experiences. No, if you just want to read Daredevil comics for the rest of your life, that is a perfectly valid choice. If you just want to read Hallmark-style romances, that's fine. Reading is not about other people. Reading is about you. Like, this whole idea that you owe anyone anything pisses me off. But you see this throughout all the sort of progressive line of thinking, feminist, SJW, like, you need to educate yourself and you need to read with intention. I'm a libertarian. If that's what you want to do, fine. But this whole attitude toward what other people should be doing is just nonsense. But again, this is NPR. This is what the people who read NPR want to hear. Oh, okay, I can be a better person and be more in touch with the Black people around me if I read books about their experience. No, how about you just talk to them like they're people? How about you try to pay attention to what's happening around you? Open your eyes. As a Latino. I've had non-Latino friends ask me to recommend Latin American authors and novels. This is fine and welcomed, but if all I have to offer the curious-minded is literature that comes from people who look like me, speak my language, or come from where I come from, that's a problem. Yeah, this is a problem created by the people who follow this line of thinking, who say we need to only write about our own experience. So your non-white friends assume that that's what you read. So that's why they come to you. Also because no one likes to use Uncle Google. Here he references someone he quoted at the beginning of the article that I skipped. It was not a matter of believing or disbelieving what I read, but of feeling something new, of being affected by something that made the look of the world different. In that moment, he was referencing how he felt upon devouring H.L. Mencken's A Book of Prefaces, a book that helped Wright find new ways of looking and seeing. You might say the same of those who only read the books they have written. Their knowledge of the world and of the systems at play will always be incomplete. This can apply to any form of media we take in, naturally, but especially the literature that non-Black and brown people choose to consume. Anti-racist books will only do a person good if they silence themselves first and enter into the reading, provided they care enough to do so. I think what he means by only read the books they have written, he means only read the books that are written by people in their culture, which, like, when it comes to white people, I don't even understand what white people is. My experience has always been that culture is what makes a difference. And for example, when I read Hillbilly Elegy, written by a white person, I did not relate to that experience. I did not grow up in that kind of culture. I could see some of what he talked about reflected in what I know of my father's experience growing up in the ghetto and experiencing the feedback from people in his culture. Why are you trying to educate yourself? Do you think you're better than us? What you should do is read what you like. And I don't think it hurts to make a little bit of effort to expand that out, to try something new every now and then. If you like sci-fi, to look for a list of lesser known sci-fi books, or ask your friends what they recommend that you read, something to mix it up every now and then. But I also think you belong to yourself. You have ownership over your own choices. If reading is something that you do to experience other lives, other people's cultures, then go forth. Decolonize your bookshelf. Fill it up with authors from all kinds of different races, ethnicities, backgrounds, etc. But if you just want to read books about animal characters, or you just want to read stupid summer romances with only white people, that's fine. If you only want to read books with Black characters or Latino characters, that's fine. That is all a valid choice. It is a personal preference. Do not make the mistake of letting anyone else make you feel bad about what you like to read or what's on your bookshelf, or make you think that you're part of the problem of systemic racism because of what's on your bookshelf. So I could rant about this topic for literal hours, but I'm going to wrap it here. If you'd like me to talk more about this subject or any related topic, please let me know. You can email me or comment below. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, please give it a like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe. And I hope to have more content for you very soon.